Thank you. Good morning and happy Saturday, everyone. Welcome to We Are Ill's Quarter 3, a distinguishing NMOSD from MS, building clarity and awareness. My name is Amber Cunningham, and I'd like to thank everyone for joining us. I'd like to also thank our sponsor, Amgen. Today, we are going to be hearing from two patient advocates, as well as we will be hearing a presentation from Dr. Mitzi. Unfortunately, Dr. Okai could not join us and be here with us this morning. So we will go ahead and get started with that presentation shortly.
Hello, hello. Happy Saturday, everybody. I'm Dr. Mitzi and super excited to be here with my friends from We Are Ill and also with Victoria and Sumaira. I know this is going to be an amazing program. So I appreciate you guys asking me to be a part of it, and let's get right into it. Okay, so first we're going to start by setting up and talking about some of the key terms, right? So we are going to be talking and focusing primarily on NMOSD, Neuromyelitis Optica Spectrum Disorder, which we'll talk in a little bit more detail about what that means and how we distinguish it from multiple sclerosis. When we talk about these diseases, they are both autoimmune disorders, meaning the immune system, the part of the body that normally attacks viruses and bacteria, gets confused and attacks a good part of the body. And they are also diseases that affect the central nervous system, which includes the brain, the spinal cord, and the optic nerves, or the nerves to the eye. One of the blood tests that specifically helps diagnose NMOSD is called aquaporin 4 antibody. And so these are antibodies that are really the target that tell us about the target of what's being affected in the central nervous system in those who have NMOSD. All right, so first let's back up. Let's talk about what is MS, because oftentimes people are much more familiar with MS than they are with NMOSD. And also a large percentage of people with NMOSD have and are misdiagnosed with multiple sclerosis. So the main hallmarks of multiple sclerosis are that it is a central nervous system disease. It is progressive. It's also an autoimmune disease, but it primarily affects the brain and the spinal cord. Some of the symptoms are very similar and overlap with those with NMOSD, including weakness, numbness, and tingling. Some people may have vision changes, optic neuritis, which we'll talk in a little bit more detail about later, and then other issues like cognitive problems or even fatigue. So where does NMOSD fit into this? So I'm, a little seasoned in this. I've been doing this for a while. And so when I first started practicing neurology, it was at a time when NMOSD was considered a part or subtype of multiple sclerosis. So we've known about NMOSD for many, many years, almost as long as we've known about MS, but it used to be considered a part of MS, and now we know it is a distinct disease. So there were studies of MS, what we called MS, in Asia, and they found that there was more involvement of the spinal cord, so people had more weakness and numbness, as well as the vision, than with MS, and it also seemed to have more severe progression. So this was first described in the 1890s, right? And we know MS was first described in the 1860s. And it was, I'm not going to try to pronounce that name or what they called it, but that's how we got Neuromyelitis Optica, was from that very interesting name there. And then it was thought to be one disease and part of MS. But as I said, eventually we came to realize that this was a distinct disease from MS. Okay, so when we think about a little bit of a timeline, right, of how this was discovered, so 1894, we knew that there were some forms of demyelinating disease where it was affecting more of the spinal cord and the vision, didn't look like typical MS, but was thought to be a part of MS. And then this is just kind of a timeline of, you know, understanding the antibody for NMOSD. So in 2002, there was thought to be a protein that was identified as the culprit for what's being attacked in NMO. And then in 2004, the antibody was found. And then 2005, we had a name for the antibody, which is the aquaporin 4 antibody. And this antibody, or sorry, this is an antibody to a water channel that's very widely expressed or is present in the optic nerves, the spinal cord, and also certain parts of the brain. So this is just kind of a visual graphic because I like pictures. and so we can see 1894, we heard about this NMO. We used to call it DeVick's disease after Dr. DeVick. And then really there was nothing much going on after 1894 because it was considered part of MS until 2004. And that's when things really started cooking. So 2004, the antibody was discovered. By 2006, there was diagnostic criteria to distinguish NMO from MS. And then by 2007, we had this, what we call spectrum of disease, where people maybe didn't have visual and spinal cord problems, but one or the other, and maybe the antibody. And then again, from 2017, there was nothing really going on to 2019, when we had the first FDA approved treatment for NMOSD. So it's really recent that we now have medications that are FDA approved for this condition. And there are, I believe, three or four treatments now. Okay, so again, this is a disease we thought was part of MS. We realized that it was actually a distinct and different disease from MS, and that the MRI lesions that we saw were different than what was seen with MS. And so this became separated as a distinct clinical syndrome outside of MS and is no longer considered part of multiple sclerosis. All right, so when we think about kind of what, again, what distinguishes it from MS, because a large percentage of those who have NMOSD have in the, you know, past 20, 30 years or so been misdiagnosed with MS. So what kind of distinguishes it clinically? So oftentimes when we think of optic neuritis or vision problems with MS, oftentimes people have one-sided vision loss. So people will say, hey, Dr. Mitzi, I lost vision in my right eye. More commonly with NMOSD, people can have one-sided vision loss, but it often is very severe. And then they also will more often have both eyes affected at the same time. Sometimes there is more severe involvement of the brainstem or the bottom part of the brain, which can control some of our automatic functions like breathing, etc. And then people will have long lesions in the spinal cord. So the lesions in the spinal cord that we see on MRI look different in NMOSD than they do with MS. And oftentimes, if there are lesions in the brain, sometimes the brain will be completely normal, but if there are lesions in the brain, they actually are very large and sometimes can be mistaken for tumors. So we used to also call, before we distinguish NMOSD as a disease, we used to call it tumefactive MS, meaning you had a big spot that looked like a tumor and led to many people having brain biopsies because we were concerned they had cancer, but they actually had demyelinating disease. And then, of course, there's this antibody that we talked about, the aquaporin 4 antibody, which is a simple blood test that can be done to determine if someone fits more into a category of NMO versus MS. All right, so what do we know about the disease in general? Who does it affect, right? So it definitely has a predominance for women. So most autoimmune diseases are more common in women than men. But this one is about 80 to 90% more common in women. So with MS, we think of a ratio of 3 to 1 affecting women to men. With NMOSD, we're talking more 8 to 1 women to men, okay? There is no difference in the gender when children are affected. The age of onset is usually 35 to 45, so a little bit older than what we think of with MS. About 20% are children that are affected, and then about 80% have that positive antibody. But again, everybody does not necessarily have that positive antibody. What we also know is that this particular condition tends to affect Asian populations more and also Black populations more as well. So the prevalence is about 10 per 100,000, which is much less than we see with MS. The incidence is about 0.2 to 4 per million. Again, it's a predilection. So people who are of various ethnic backgrounds are more likely affected than people we would consider white or of Northern European ancestry. And those who are of varied ethnic backgrounds, including those who are Asian as well as Black or African descent, seem to have more brain attacks, which can be more severe. So let's get a little bit more into the nitty gritty of some of the symptoms, right? So transverse myelitis is one of the hallmark symptoms that we see with NMOSD. And transverse myelitis basically means you have a lesion in your spinal cord that causes damage. It doesn't tell us what it's from. Transverse myelitis can happen with MS. Transverse myelitis can also happen with NMOSD. But what we see with NMOSD is that people may often have more severe symptoms. And they also have the lesions we call longitudinally extensive. So they're long. Whereas with MS, you have short lesions, you know, so you have a little dot here, a little dot there, but it's not like one long spot or one long area of damage affecting the spinal cord. And so the symptoms that we can see can be weakness, they could be numbness and tingling, people can have spasms. Again, more often than not, the symptoms can be more severe. So someone may have paralysis where a limb or extremity doesn't move at all. And so most of the lesions, as we said on the bottom, over 50% are longitudinally extensive lesions in the spinal cord. And so this is the type of transverse myelitis that we see with NMOSD. So what about optic neuritis? Again, this is a symptom that we see with MS. Some people can have optic neuritis and not have any other symptoms of demyelinating disease, but certainly this is one that raises concern. And optic neuritis, we can see the comparison between NMOSD and MS. Certainly people can have vision loss. Sometimes they can have decreased color vision. Sometimes they can have spots in their vision, but we more often see blindness with NMOSD. So there may be more severe vision loss and there also may be poorer recovery. And then also we talked about earlier that people more often have bilateral or both eyes affected with optic neuritis in NMOSD than they may have with MS. So then again, other parts of the brain that are affected. So classically, when we think of NMOSD, we think that there's not much brain involvement, but we do know that there can be specific syndromes or areas that are involved. One of them is an area we call the area postrema. I have no idea how I got that name, but the symptoms of that area being involved are things like hiccups, intractable hiccups, nausea and vomiting. And so I have had multiple patients who've gone to the ER for nausea and vomiting that won't go away and been thought to have a stomach symptom, but really it was due to a lesion in the brain because they had NMOSD. So again, there are specific syndromes that we can see in the brain and brain stem that are more typical of NMOSD. We don't typically see that syndrome as much with multiple sclerosis. So why is it important, you know, to treat this disease? You know, I think number one, it's important to treat it because it is a demyelinating disease and it's affecting the central nervous system, but particularly because the outcomes from a relapse can be extremely devastating. With MS, certainly relapses can be devastating, but we see recovery a lot more often with MS relapses versus NMOSD. And so it's important to have a comprehensive care team. So looking at your neurologist, who is the primary kind of leader, head cheerleader of your team, you know, directing treatment, and then certainly a primary care physician to do screening and checking for all of those, you know, regular things. We saw the ages were 35 to 45. So that's around the time women start getting mammograms and all that good stuff. Also, it's important to have other specialists, depending on what symptoms are involved, physical therapists, mental health specialists as well. So comprehensive care is key to good outcomes for those living with both MS and NMOSD. So when we think about treatment, you know, I always like to think of treatment as a four-layer cake because I like cake. So the first layer is certainly if someone has an acute relapse or episode. So an acute relapse or episode, it initially is treated very similarly to what we would do with multiple sclerosis. So a person can be treated with IV corticosteroids or high-dose steroids. Sometimes if people don't respond to that, there is another procedure called plasma exchange that can be done. It's almost like dialysis. Yes, I like cake. I saw cake for Dr. Mitzi. Yes. It is almost like a dialysis that can be done to kind of wash the antibodies out. And then sometimes there are other treatments like IVIG, which used to be used very commonly for MS, but still can be used for NMOSD. It also is important to recognize that some of the treatments, the disease modifying treatments for multiple sclerosis can worsen NMOSD. So that's why an accurate diagnosis is extremely important, because we don't want to give you something that's going to make your NMOSD worse. I'm not going to go into detail about each of these, but again, important to recognize that there are now several FDA approved treatments for NMOSD, and we have come a long way. So this is just 2019, right? Where the first one was approved right before the pandemic. So again, we have a disease we've recognized in 1894 that became a distinct disease in 2002. And then it wasn't until 2019 that there were actually medications that were approved to treat this. So again, very exciting. We have a long way to go, but I think we also have come a long way in being able to treat this potentially very disabling condition. So what now? There certainly is still a lot of work that needs to be done looking at NMOSD in underrepresented communities. So although the disease more commonly affects Asian populations and Black populations, when we look at the research is often done on European populations, right? So there's still a lot of work to do to better understand how this affects certain communities as well as the burden of disease. It also is important for us to make sure we raise awareness in the community so people are aware of these symptoms, you know, so that they can get adequately treated and appropriately diagnosed. And of course, you know, I'm always an advocate for increasing diversity in clinical trials, and we need more people of varied backgrounds in our clinical research to really understand this condition and to help us to treat it effectively for everyone.
All right, that was some great information to really be able to determine the difference between the two diseases there. Now we're going to have our first speaker. She is WeRL's very own program manager, Ms. Brianna Pearson.
Hello, everyone. My name is Brianna Pearson. Thank you so much for joining us today. I am WeRL's program manager and an MS advocate, obviously, and I just tried to show you guys a small glimpse into what the last 3 years now have looked like for me. And today I'll be going over my diagnosis, kind of finding my way, symptoms, and maintaining wellness with MS. So my diagnosis story: I was diagnosed 3 years ago. And I woke up one day, this was about a week before my 2 year wedding anniversary, and it felt like a little spot in my left eye that I just, like, maybe it was a floaty, I couldn't see, it was blurry. And that was that weekend. I actually thought my toddler at the time kind of headbutted me the night before. So a few days went on, didn't go away. And then that Thursday, which was actually my wedding anniversary, my husband said, "Hey, why don't you go to an eye urgent care?" And I'm like, "No, we have dinner plans. Like, I don't want to deal with it tonight." But I did end up calling. They had an appointment available for later that evening, and I let the guy know that I would call back. And then I continued working for the day, and something just kept eating at me to just go do it today. So I did. We went to the appointment. They began the eye examination, but they weren't finding anything visibly wrong with my eye. And it wasn't until they had me cover one of the eyes that I realized that I couldn't see anything out of my left eye. It wasn't just a spot. I didn't think to do that because with both of my eyes open, it just felt like that one little spot. And the physician there let me know that she thinks it could be optic neuritis, and she wanted me to go to the emergency room to get an MRI that next day. And she also let me know that I would be admitted to get the steroid infusion. So everything happened really, really fast. We were still in the thick of COVID. So I waited for about 24 hours in the ER to be seen. I got the a full body scan, brain MRIs, my whole spine. And by the end of that night, they were running tests and blood work. They finally let my husband back because, again, it was the thick of COVID, so they weren't letting anybody back. And I had a team of doctors let me know that my MRI results were conclusive to MS. So that, of course, world comes crashing down, right? I ended up doing the spinal tap in the hospital. I stayed for 3 days, and then I was discharged home. My eyesight was not all the way back, maybe a 10% difference. And just between that and trying to follow the taper schedules with steroids, trying to get a follow-up appointment, which I never got from that healthcare facility, about a month went by, and I did end up finding an MS specialist to go to. Great physician. I think he's the reason why I did get back on track so quickly. But the day of my appointment, I woke up, and again, this was a month later, and there was a spot on my left arm that was numb. So we went to the appointment. He confirmed the diagnosis and told me I need to go to get another MRI because of the whole numbness in my arm. I did that, and it was another relapse. I had a spinal lesion. But this time around, I did 5 days at the hospital and around the clock steroid infusions. And that's pretty much the basis of my diagnosis story. I started treatment after that. I did about a year on Tysabri, and then I'm now on Ocrevus. So that's twice a year. So if I move on to finding my way, I think I can't really say that without acknowledging how significant We Are Ill has been in this whole process. I was a mess. I was not handling this diagnosis well. I was emotional, just really bad. And then I found We Are Ill on Instagram and decided to go to that wellness weekend. There is when I found community. I saw people who looked like me. I didn't feel as alone. And I felt really inspired to just start this advocacy work. And they supported that. And then fast forward, I am now the program manager for We Are Ill. It's kind of not history after that. So daily symptoms, my vision does still get blurry from time to time. I have extreme light sensitivity. And as far as the numbness that happened with my left arm, it did spread to my entire left side of my body. And I still deal with that and just nerve pain, fatigue. So those are some of the things that I live with on a daily basis, despite treatment. You know, those things aren't really geared toward improving symptoms. Once the damage is done, it's kind of just done. And maintaining wellness. This one, I'll be really transparent. I have not been completely healthy and as clean and just into exercise as I should have been. I would say this last year or so, I finally got a handle on just a balanced diet, a regular exercise routine. And I can say that it did help a lot. So yeah, that's my story.
Thank you, Brianna, for sharing. And now we have our second patient advocate, Ms. Marion Jones.
Good morning, everyone. First, I just want to thank the incredible team at We Are Ill for coordinating these events to continue to educate patients and to bring us together in this way to share our own personal stories. So as Amber shared, I am an NMO advocate and patient myself. I was actually diagnosed with NMO in November of 2020. And so I'm just going to, you know, spend some time talking about the early onset of the diagnosis. I'll talk about, you know, what happened during my first ER visit. I'll, you know, talk about some of the treatment modality that I had to undergo after being diagnosed. I'll talk about relapsing, the symptoms, my stint in a rehabilitation facility, and then I'll bring it up to current, you know, life after the diagnosis and how I'm managing NMO on a daily. And I just also want to say that I do have a presence on social media, more so on Instagram than TikTok, but I do have a TikTok. So if you'd like to follow me after this, just for any questions that you might have, if you're newly diagnosed or just anything about my journey, I'm happy to continue the conversation. So as I shared, I was diagnosed in November of 2020. And, you know, it started as just a headache. I actually had a headache that lingered on for much too long, you know, for I would say probably about 6 weeks. I was trying to self-medicate. And then I had a friend that said, you know what, maybe you should go into the ER and, you know, and just, you know, get kind of an analysis of what's going on. So I went into the ER. They asked if I had a history of migraines, which I never had a history of migraines. And they also asked if, you know, if my family had a history of migraines. And so, you know, the answer to that was no as well. So from that first ER visit, they provided me with some medication, muscle relaxers, and they said, you know what, you're young, you seem to be relatively healthy, and they, you know, they released me. So I went home and, you know, I took the muscle relaxers. I'd never taken muscle relaxers before, so I really didn't know what to expect. And so after about, you know, kind of 24 to 48 hours, you know, there was, you know, really no relief in terms of the headache, but I noticed weakness on one side of my body. You know, it started to kind of drag, even, you know, trying to, you know, remove the water pitcher out of the refrigerator became impossible. And, you know, I started to feel, you know, just like this sluggish movement on one side of my body. And I had a friend say to me, you know, that isn't, you know, that shouldn't be happening as a result of you taking muscle relaxers. So I think you should go back to the ER. So that was, thank God for friends in your life who can just help you see things from a different perspective, because that was my experience. So I went back to the ER, and at the time, you know, I told them about the sluggish and the dragging. And so I think that probably prompted them to, you know, pull a neurologist into the conversation. And so the neurologist that was on staff that night just happened to be the MS specialist. He, you know, oversaw the MS division for this hospital. And I got an MRI. He reviewed the MRI and came and told me, he said, I have some news that, you know, it's not good news for you. He said, you have an autoimmune disease. It's, you know, neuromyelitis optica. He said it is a lifelong condition. There is no cure. And he said, you know, there's one thing that I want to do just to, you know, to find out more. And so I received a spinal tap. And from that spinal tap, they determined that I was, you know, aquaporin 4. The neurologist during the presentation earlier spoke about that. So I was positive for, you know, AQP4 positive, which is just a certain type of marker in NMO patients. Not all NMO patients are AQP4 positive, but I just so happened to be positive for that aquaporin. And so after that, we started, you know, talking about, you know, treatment options. And mind you, I was devastated. You know, everything was it was like a fire hose. Everything was coming at me. I couldn't keep up with
you know, him saying that I had a lifelong condition, there was no cure. So I'm trying to figure out, you know, how much time do I have? What, you know, what's, you know, what is this? I'm devastated. It's COVID. There's no family in the hospital with me at the time. You know, and so he said, we're going to have to, you know, admit you into the ICU, because I was asking, you know, do I need to contact my employer? How much time, you know, do I need to take off, et cetera. And so long story short, I started on a drug that I relapsed on. And so, you know, I relapsed on that drug, and that caused me to have to go back to the ICU. And when I went back to the ICU, I started another drug, and that particular drug is a drug that I'm on today. But, you know, through that process of relapsing, which is a devastating, you know, situation in itself, I was admitted to a rehabilitation facility. So the picture that you see with my walker behind me in wheelchair, those were, you know, I was, you know, there was a time when I was using the walker to get around, and there was a time when I was using the wheelchair to get around, because I had to learn how to walk again. I was partially paralyzed on the left side of my body after the relapse. And so it, you know, it speaks to just, you know, the importance of being educated about the drug options, because the drug that I'm on now is a treatment that we should have started out with, and that would have prevented that relapse that happened. And so after coming out of the rehabilitation facility, you know, I'll get into just like, you know, just life after diagnosis. You know, you have these things that happen, but you have to, you know, just life happens, you know, and what are you going to do kind of after it happens? And so for me, you know, my faith has been a significant foundation for me, just getting through NMO and just getting through life in general. And so that's how I've been, you know, maintaining, also finding community. You know, I was fortunate to find the Sumaira Foundation, and to, you know, get connected with other people, as Brianna said, you know, who looked like me, who was living my experience. And so when I talked about these feelings that I had, you know, nerve pains and things of that nature, it wasn't a foreign conversation. They completely understood, and they understand today. So now I serve as a patient advocate myself, and I travel, you know, across the country for patient day events, and also to Capitol Hill to talk to our elected officials about policies and advocating for policies that impact those that are living with rare diseases. And I continue to, you know, run along this journey, you know, literally and figuratively. After the diagnosis, I said, you know, I want to get back into running. That was something I was doing before, you know, 5Ks here and there. But last year, I challenged myself in March of last year. I said, you know what? I want to run a marathon. And I was planning to run my first marathon this year, but I got a little ambitious thanks to a great friend of mine who is a runner. And I ran my first marathon in November of last year. And I'm prepping right now for the Chicago Marathon. So I would say, you know, community just is so important, and, you know, staying positive and knowing that, you know, you can get through, you know, NMO, you can get through MS, you know, it's, you know, mindset is really important, and who you're surrounding yourself with is important as well. And so I'll pause there because I know we're getting close to time, but happy to answer any questions that anyone might have.
All right. And does anyone have any questions for either Brianna or Miss Marion Jones? And thank you, Marion, for sharing your story. That is awesome that you're running. That's really awesome. So I'll give everybody a moment. We'll just wait a second and see if anyone has a question or two. Right. And to finish up things here, I did want to just mention and let everyone know about our awesome annual event that we are host in Atlanta, Georgia. It's coming up in on the 1st of November. It's November 1st through November 3rd. It is called Wellness Weekend. Again, it's an annual event that brings together our community. We fellowship, there's a sense of community, there's important information that's provided from neurologists, there's different panelist speakers, and it's just a wealth of information that is so helpful. And it's a space like no other. Being able to have all those people around you who look like you and are going through the same things is such an amazing experience, and I can't share it enough. You can get tickets at our website or through the Instagram page. So if you have not, definitely look into it. It's definitely an experience. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us. We really, really appreciate you guys. Again, thank you to our sponsors at Amgen as well. And actually, I apologize. I do see a question. I see a question in regard to becoming an advocate. Did either one of our lovely speakers want to comment on that?
I have it up. Sharon asked, how do you become an advocate?
Okay. So I'm happy to share, and then Brianna, I can turn it over to you. So for me, I joined a nonprofit organization, the Sumaira Foundation, which focuses on research and creating community for those who live with NMO and MOGAD, which is another autoimmune condition. And just through that process of joining, you know, there's an opportunity where they extend, you know, patient advocacy to individuals who are a part of the organization. So I would say to become an advocate, there are a number of different nonprofit organizations in the rare disease space. So if you just really did really a Google search on rare disease advocacy, there are some organizations that you can become a part of, and they will actually take you through the training process of, you know, becoming an advocate, how to, you know, advocate for yourself, what the process looks like when you're going to DC to meet with elected officials and things of that nature. So there are a couple of different organizations that are out there, and if we have time, I'll try and drop some in the chat while Brianna comments on her thoughts around advocacy.
So thank you. My camera is really weird right now, but thank you for that question. I would just say, honestly, I can speak from the MS perspective. I think I originally went through the National MS Society, just finding on Instagram. And that's how I ended up finding We Are Ill. But just in general, like Marion mentioned, just Googling advocacy work, there are so many different organizations that you can find, like the Autoimmune Association, which is how I met Marion. We went to DC together. And then just all of the work that I'm doing with We Are Ill and her foundation, it's just about kind of doing a little research, I think, but maybe starting off with more of a national organization I guess it could help me find stuff too. Does that help?
All right, and we have one additional question for Marion. The question is, how did you make it to running your first marathon, and what an accomplishment? And I second that.
So I had, you know, last year I actually flew out to Tokyo with a friend who was running the Tokyo Marathon. And I was there, it was one of my first, I think, international trips that I took after being diagnosed. And I was just watching runners and I was so inspired by, you know, I was there and I was going, wow, you know, one day I want to be out there running a marathon as a rare disease patient. And so when I made it back to the States, you know, I reached out to a friend of mine who is an avid runner. And I said, you know, I want to start training for a marathon, because she's run multiple marathons. And I said, I want to do my first marathon next year, 2024. And she said, you know, if you start training now, by the fall, you'll be ready to do your first marathon. And I was going, she has no idea who I am in terms of my health situation. But I started in around March, end of March of last year, I started training. And you know, there were some days when I was thinking, like, what am I doing? Like, I'm living with a rare disease. I'm fatigued all the time. How am I going to, you know, how am I going to do this? But I think what I learned in that process is we are so much stronger than we think, you know, and, you know, our bodies will actually, you know, do, and it can, our bodies can be pushed to the limit, you know, and it's also about, like, knowing your body, obviously, with living with a rare disease. So knowing what you can take and understanding your tolerance level. And so even just the process of preparing for the marathon, I was learning about this new body that I had, you know? And so the days when I was completely exhausted and I just felt like I couldn't do my run, you know, I took a break. And there were some times when I said, you know, I'm tired, but I'm going to just see if I can get, you know, another few miles in. And a lot of it was just, you know, even when you're running a marathon or any race, it's about you versus you. And so I just was encouraged, you know, I said, I'm going to do this and I'm going to show other patients that we can do this, you know, that being rare is actually a superpower. And so that's just how I got through it. You know, really just having someone, you know, like my friend at the time saying, you know what, you can do this, and believing that I could do it. And, you know, just kind of going through the process of until I got across that finish line.
All right. Thank you again, everyone, for joining us. I hope everyone has a amazing remainder of the day, and everyone take care.